Well, good evening, beautiful people. One more time. Good evening, beautiful people. There we go. There we go. I'm Chuck Henson, and I have the privilege of serving you as Interim Vice Chancellor for Inclusion, Diversity, and Equity. Welcome to the inaugural lecture in the African American Experience in Missouri Lecture Series. I'd like to pay respect and thanks to our honored guests and the group of truly inspiring people that I have been blessed to meet here at the University of Missouri and also blessed to associate with in my work. Let's recognize President Mike and Dr. Julie Middleton. Chancellor Hank and Dr. Karen Foley. Our Board of Curators, chaired by Pam Henriksen. Phil Snowden. John Phillips. Is John? Don Cups. And Marcy Graham. And David Steelman. I'd also like to recognize Mr. Chris Kelly, former Missouri State Representative. Mr. Kelly, are you in the house? And the Honorable Stephen N. Limbaugh, Jr., President of the State Historical Society of Missouri, who I will bring out momentarily, and Mr. Rodney Boyd. I'd also like to thank the following beautiful people for being the inspiration and brains behind this series and the fantastic work that Mizzou has done and is doing to respond to the call for a better relationship within our community. So thank you, Noor Azizan Gardner, who could literally just be Noor like the great musician Prince is just Prince. Noor. And thank you, Hank Foley, you wonderful, interesting scientist man, for having the idea of the series in the first place, and his complete support of our work, and his work with Dr. Gary Kremer, the director of the State Historical Society of Missouri. And thank you, Dr. Kremer, for bringing this together and bringing us together with Dr. Keona Irvin. Thank you. And you're going to meet Dr. Irvin shortly, but I want to thank her for her willingness to co-curate this series and act as a guiding force throughout the series as it continues and matures. Can we have a big hand for Dr. Irvin? And thanks to Drs. Stephanie Shonikan, I saw Dr. Shonikan, and Dr. Joan Hermson for their leadership and inspiration in so many ways, but it's a personal thanks for their inspiration to me and their support, and a specific thanks to Dr. Garnet Stokes, our provost, for her steadfast support of this effort and all of the work of the Division of Inclusion, Diversity, and Equity. And finally, none of this would have been possible. Are you ready? Without the tireless efforts of Rebecca Calvin and Mary Ellen Lohman and the awesome cooperation of Donna Paleo and the University Advanced staff. So let's please thank them. I know that I haven't mentioned all the names. It would take the entire night. Please know that from the bottom of my heart, I thank you all. This lecture series is about our history. It's meant to give us the facts about our history. It is meant to empower us to talk about our history. It's a history that we faced every day without really embracing it or confronting it. And for that reason, we are taking this opportunity to share our history. And by share, I mean in the fellowship of Jesse Auditorium here, and in hearing the words and experiencing this experience together. I hope that as we begin to celebrate our history, we will cease to fear our history. And we will recognize the impact of our history on ourselves and each other. And as we do so, we will become empowered in our ability to understand each other better and understand our experiences with each other better, and thereby validate our relationships with each other and the truth of our shared experience. So allow me, with the greatest pleasure, to introduce Judge Stephen N. Limbaugh, President of the State Historical Society of Missouri. Join me in welcoming him.
Have all your gear now.
No,
Professor.
I got it all.
Good. Thank you. It has been my honor, as Professor Henson mentioned, to serve as President of the State Historical Society for quite some time now. We have, Professor mentioned one of our trustees, Rodney Boyd, if you'd stand too. We have another one, Brent Schondelmeyer. I saw Brent earlier. And then I'll introduce Dr. Kramer here in a minute. I want to welcome you on behalf of the trustees of the State Historical Society. This is a wonderful collaboration between our two organizations, the University and the State Historical Society. And so you'll know, our collaboration has been for the entire life of the State Historical Society, which began in 1898 with its creation by the Missouri Press Association. Did you know that our society has been housed at the ground floor in the basement of Ellis Library since 1916 for 100 years? And yes, we were the first tenant along with the library itself, because that is the year that Ellis Library was completed. A little bit more about the society for those of you who aren't familiar with our organization. Just let me give you several components of our work. Consistent with the fact that we were founded by the Missouri Press Association, although later we were given the imprimatur of the state legislature and we are now an independent state entity. But we have what may be the largest newspaper microfilm collection in the nation outside of the Library of Congress. Then we have manuscript collections that are so vast and irreplaceable and altogether magnificent. They encompass thousands of linear square feet of room, and they consist of everything from a handwritten map of the Mississippi River drawn in the late 1700s by none other than Clark of the Lewis and Clark expedition, years before the expedition actually took place. We have things like the original diaries from the 1820s and 1830s of the old Methodist circuit riders. And our most recent acquisitions today are the collected professional papers of our most prominent politicians like Bond and Danforth and Symington and Eagleton. Then another component is our magnificent art gallery. We have the third largest art gallery in the state of Missouri, and it features our two most prominent Missouri painters, George Calem Bingham and Thomas Hart Benton. Did you know that our paintings of just those two painters alone have been appraised 10 years ago now at more than $100 million? Nobody knows they're there, hardly. And then finally, I'll mention too, since 1906, for 110 years, the Society has published the preeminent scholarly journal on Missouri history, which is the Missouri Historic Review on a quarterly basis. Well, that's something about our organization, but as I said, we've been there at Ellis Library for 100 years now, and we have been woefully out of space for a couple of generations. And so we had a windfall last year with the legislature, so much so that they have, the legislature has allotted or enacted a bill that will provide $35 million in bond money for the construction of a new facility. And I'm so pleased to mention that we will not be leaving the campus. The physical plant will be on the Elm Street corridor, which eventually we hope will be a museum corridor for the City of Columbia and the university itself, right across from Peace Park, a beautiful setting. And so we hope to begin construction in 2017 on that new facility, and that will provide additional space for the library expansion, too, that you all have needed for so many years as well. But not only will we be physically present on campus, we will still be here to fully integrate with the university and the mission, the academic mission of the university. It is altogether appropriate that this organization is co-sponsoring the lecture series on the African-American experience in Missouri because of the fact our executive director is one of the preeminent authorities on that subject. Dr. Kramer, back in the late 60s, studied under the legendary Lorenzo Green at Lincoln University. And he was there back when that was mainly a black institution. And so after his graduation there and his mentorship from Dr. Green, he obtained his PhD from the American University in Washington, D.C., came back here, taught at William Woods and at Lincoln, served a term as the state archivist for then Secretary of State, now U.S. Senator Roy Blunt. But Dr. Kramer has indeed devoted his entire professional career to the scholarly study of the African-American experience in Missouri. And it's, as I say, it's very appropriate that he is one of the co-founders of this new program. He's written 12 books. Wait. Most of them are on the African-American experience. I have these two prominently displayed on my desk, and I picked them up. The first is a biography of George Washington Carver, a Missouri native. The second is an anthology of Dr. Kramer's published articles. This is called Race and Meaning, the African-American Experience in Missouri. And yes, these are for sale at a modest price at the Society Bookstore. So. I've run out of time, but let me tell you how excited we are about this lecture series. And I just wanted to point to one of the lectures that will not happen not this year, but next year, because we're trying to do these in some sort of chronological order. And that is a presentation on the famous case of Lloyd Gaines versus Canada. Now, Canada is not the country. Canada was the name of the registrar of the University of Missouri at the time. And many of you know this story, but in the mid-1930s, Lloyd Gaines, a recent graduate of Lincoln University, applied for admission to the law school. He was perfectly qualified in every respect, except for the fact that he was a black man. And the predecessors of you curators at the time had the idea then that black people shouldn't be admitted to the University of Missouri. And so they knew that the law required some separate but equal accommodation under the case of Plessy versus Ferguson. So here's how they concocted the scheme. They said, well, we're not going to let you come to Columbia, but we'll send you to the law school at Nebraska or the law school at Iowa. Both schools allowed black attendees at the time. Well, I know President Middleton and Professor Henson will agree with me on this point, that to say that the law school at Nebraska or Iowa was equal to that at the University of Missouri, that is a dubious proposition indeed. With that, I'll leave the rest of the story to the professional presenters at a later date, and I'll ask our Master of Ceremonies, Keona Irvin, to come forward.
Good evening. Thank you for coming. On behalf of my colleague and co-director, Gary Kramer, welcome. We're delighted to have Dr. Diane Mutti Burke, Associate Professor of History at the University of Missouri, Kansas City, to give the inaugural lecture for the African American Experience in Missouri series. Now, the lecture series will explore the history of Black Americans in Missouri from the earliest period of statehood to the present. We offer this series to the university community and the public to provide an opportunity to learn from top scholars in the field. Over the next year and a half, we will host more than a dozen scholars who will give presentations on everything from slavery to political activism, the meaning of race to urban decline, and the rise of jazz culture to the history of Black institutions. Our lecture series developed in response to the campus protest over racial issues at MU last fall, and more broadly to the events in Ferguson in 2014. It is no coincidence that Missouri became ground zero for Black political insurgency and the emergence of national dialogues and debates about race and racism. If our lecture series has a thesis, it would be that a working knowledge of the history of Missouri, particularly through the lens of Black experiences, is key to understanding the nature and evolution of race and racism in America, and appreciating the broad scope, long tradition, and extensive impact of Black freedom struggles, Black cultural productions, and Black community building. A border state where slavery was practiced legally, Missouri was home to deeply consequential racial tensions for much of its history. These tensions were the product of what one writer termed a, quote, tradition of anti-Black racism, and along with it, a deep tradition of Black resistance. This lecture series centers Black Missourians, how they made themselves in an often hostile environment, created livelihoods, formed families and communities and networks, fashioned cultures, resisted and organized, and consistently defied notions of a monolithic, quote unquote, Black community. Now, the essayist and novelist James Baldwin captures the sensibility that frames our approach. Baldwin, of course, puts it far more eloquently than we ever could. He observed that, quote, history does not refer merely or even principally to the past. On the contrary, the great force of history comes from the fact that we carry it within us, that history is literally present in all that we do. This lecture series is meant to convey the great force of history evident in our contemporary reality and struggle. Now, mark your calendars. I have a few exciting announcements to make. Martha S. Jones, the Arthur F. Thurnar Professor at the University of Michigan, author of All Bound Up Together, The Woman Question in African American Public Culture, 1830 to 1900, and co-editor of Toward an Intellectual History of Black Women, will present the lecture, hashtag Say Her Name, Black Women and State Violence in the Case of Missouri versus Celia, a Slave, on March 23rd at 7 p.m. right here in Jesse Auditorium. Jones will share the powerful and tragic story of Celia, who was purchased by a local man in Callaway County and suffered tremendously for years before she stood up for her basic human right to decide her own fate. In addition to her own scholarship, Professor Jones is also the co-director of the Michigan Law Program in Race, Law, and History, as well as the Celia Project, which generates new research on the history of sexual violence, women, and slavery. And while details are still being confirmed, we are pleased to announce that on the evening of April 21st at the Missouri Theater, Walter Johnson, the Winthrop Professor of History, Professor of African and African American Studies, and the director of the Charles Warren Center for Studies in American History at Harvard University, will give a lecture on the central role of St. Louis in the imperialist and racial capitalist history of the United States in the 19th century. Trust me, you don't want to miss our upcoming lectures, so please plan to attend. Now, finally, to tonight's talk. Professor Mutti Burke's award-winning first book, On Slavery's Border, Missouri's Small Slaving Households, 1815 to 1865, was published by the University of Georgia Press in 2010. Professor Mutti Burke has written a number of articles about slavery, women, and the Civil War in Missouri. She co-edited with her colleague John Herron a collection of articles about Kansas City from the Missouri Historical Review called Kansas City, America's Crossroads, as well as a new collection of scholarly articles on the Missouri-Kansas Border War called Bleeding Kansas, Bleeding Missouri, The Long Civil War on the Border, co-edited with Jonathan Earle and published by the University Press of Kansas in 2013. The articles in this collection were the product of a major public conference on the Civil War on the border held at the Kansas City Public Library in November 2011. In addition, Dr. Mutti Burke has started work on a monograph about refugee populations during the Civil War. Professor Mutti Burke is deeply engaged in bringing the history of this region to the public through her role as the director of UMKC's Center for Midwestern Studies. She regularly speaks to public audiences and consulted with a number of cultural institutions in the region about their Civil War sesquicentennial programming. She also directs a National Endowment for the Humanities, Landmarks of American History and Culture workshops on the UMKC campus. This program brings 80 teachers from throughout the nation to attend week-long classes on the Kansas and Missouri border wars. Please note that a book signing on slavery's border will immediately follow the talk. Let's welcome Professor Mutti Burke to the podium.
Thank you. I'm so pleased to be here tonight. I think this is a wonderful lecture series that they're planning, and it's very important to try to understand this history, the very often troubling race relations in the state. And I think it's also important to gain a greater appreciation for the resiliency and the accomplishments of African Americans. So in order for us to move forward, I think we need to understand this history, as so many people have already said tonight. So thank you to Dr. Kramer and to Dr. Irvin and to the Chancellor and to everyone who has organized and supported this program. I really appreciate the opportunity to play just a small role in advancing what I think is a very important conversation.
Okay, I'll leave this quote up for you to look at here for a minute. 40 years after the Civil War, John G. Haskell evoked a world of slaveholding and slavery that differed significantly from the descriptions of large cotton or rice plantations, complete with the big house and the slave quarters, that had become the quintessential representation of the antebellum South. Haskell described slavery in Missouri as a highly personal system of economic and social relations, much more, quote, domestic than what prevailed in the plantation South. Now, Haskell's argument about the mild nature of border slavery reached back to the years before the Civil War, when Missourians had a vested interest in promoting their image as benevolent slaveholders. Most Missourians, even many who were enslaved, imagined that conditions were better in Missouri than downriver in the Cotton Kingdom. In the decades that followed the war, beliefs about the mild nature of border state slavery became more firmly entrenched in white Missourians' collective consciousness. Their memories of slavery and the Civil War were complicated by the often personal and vicious nature of the experience of war in a border state where residents fought on both sides of the conflict. The individuals who recorded their wartime memories were most interested in cataloging the atrocities perpetrated by their enemies. There was a lot of talk of Jayhawkers. But some also made it a priority to describe the perfection of Missouri's slaveholding society before it was devastated by the war. The faithful slaves who populated the state's farms were a special focus of their memories. They portrayed slaves as suffering for nothing, content in their enslavement, and reluctant to leave their owners. White Southerners at the time told similar stories, of course, as they celebrated a world that was no longer and justified both their lost cause and the South's emerging system of racial segregation. But Missourians enhanced this well-known Southern story of slavery by repeatedly emphasizing the highly familial nature of the small-scale system of slavery that once existed in the state. Therefore, it's not surprising that Haskell described Missouri slavery as domestic, because the white people he interviewed assured him it had been so. As the 20th century approached, white Missourians, regardless of the side their ancestors fought on during the war, began to closely align themselves with the South and Jim Crow. And their memories of Missouri's milder form of slavery reinforced their contemporary system of racial subjugation. Now, this image of mild border slavery has persisted in spite of the more complex picture painted by the individuals who actually endured enslavement in the state. Men and women who were interviewed in the 1930s remembered their experiences of slavery in a myriad of ways, ranging from kind treatment at the hands of their owners to the very worst forms of psychological and physical abuse. The life story of William Wells Brown, who was an escaped Missouri slave, an abolitionist lecturer and novelist, also represents the broad range of experiences faced by enslaved Missourians. Now, likely mindful of white Missourians' boasts that they treated their slaves more humanely than elsewhere, Brown argued that their so-called kind treatment was meaningless, because ultimately, quote, slavery decrees that the slave shall not worship God according to the dictates of his own conscience. It denies him the word of God. It makes him a chattel and sells him in the market to the highest bidder. It decrees that he shall not protect the wife of his bosom. It takes from him every right which God gave him. Clothing and food are nothing compared with liberty. What care I for clothing or food when I am a slave of another, he said. Regrettably, white Missourians' self-serving memories of mild border slavery have outlasted formerly enslaved Missourians' criticisms of the system. And even today, many, many people believe that slavery was somehow better here. Now, lack of historical research on small slave holdings and border state slavery has compounded this tendency. Scholars have devoted literally thousands upon thousands of pages to debunking the Moonlight and Magnolia myth of the Old South. But these really important correctives, by and large, have failed to examine the experiences of the many black and white Southerners who lived on small slaveholding farms in the upper or border upland or border south. Thus allowing for the persistence of the idea that slavery was easier to endure in the border states. Indeed, the history of slaves and slaveholders on large plantations tells only one aspect of the story of slavery in the American South. A vast majority of white people who owned slaves and nearly half of enslaved people lived on farms rather than plantations. In spite of these numbers, most historians simply have not bothered to open up the doors of small slaveholders' homes and examine the relationships and the lives of the individuals found within. So how owners and slaves lived and worked together each day, how the circumstances of small-scale slavery affected their family lives, and how they socialized with their neighbors. This tendency to ignore the effects of slaveholding size has been accompanied by a neglect of regional differences as well. Historians have traditionally considered Missouri to be on the periphery of the slave South, and therefore they have ignored the state in their larger examinations of slavery and Southern society. What they've done is they've focused on the fact that there were actually many fewer slaves in Missouri than in most other Southern states. But in just looking at the numbers, what they've done is they've ignored the importance of slavery to the state's economy and society, as well as Missouri's crucial involvement in the ongoing sectional crisis, including the controversy over statehood, the Missouri Compromise, and the status of slavery in Kansas. All of this provokes the question of whether the experience of slavery and slaveholding was actually different in Missouri than elsewhere in the South. Now, I've attempted to provide an answer to this question by examining how both the size of slaveholdings and the geographical location influence the experience of slavery and slaveholding in the state. Missouri developed into a region dominated by small slaveholdings precisely because of its geographic location. So both the climate and proximity to free states discouraged the migration of wealthy planters. So this is people that owned usually more than 20 slaves. Instead, settlers hailing from the backcountry of the Upper South flocked to the Mississippi and Missouri River valleys, to places like Boone County, hoping to better their economic and social conditions. So as you can see, the Missouri River counties, in the western part of the state, the area that was later called Little Dixie had the largest concentration of slaves. In some counties, enslaved residents comprised over 30% of the total population of those counties. For example, in 1860, Boone County had the third largest slave population of all Missouri counties, with 5,034 slaves, and that was 26% of the total population of the county. But in spite of these numbers and these large concentrations of slaves in certain parts of the state was, by and large, a haven for small slaveholders. Nearly 90% of Missouri slaveholders owned 10 or fewer slaves. Even as late as 1860, the average slaveholding in Missouri was between 4 and 5 slaves. It was actually 4.7 if you ran the numbers. Once in the West, both slaveholders and slaves quickly set about building farms and communities that resembled those that they left behind in their Eastern homes. This included establishing institutions like the University of Missouri, which opened in 1841 and was financed by elite Boone County men, including slaveholders. In the end, the thousands of westward migrating Southerners far surpassed their original intentions of replicating an Eastern small slaveholding paradigm and instead created a distinctive slave society in which small slaveholders reigned supreme. The small-scale system of slavery that emerged in the state profoundly influenced the experiences of enslaved Missourians. Now, at its foundation, slavery was a system of labor exploitation and social and racial control, in which the master class wielded ultimate and often brutal power over enslaved people. Yet, slaves continually resisted the control that slaveholders attempted to exert over them and worked to influence both the terms of their labor and their family and community lives. Now, scholars have found this to be the case on the South's plantations, but I argue that this tendency was exacerbated in a place such as Missouri, where the state's unique geography and the resulting preponderance of small slaveholdings resulted in significant differences in daily living and working conditions for slaveholders and slaves from those found on the plantations of the Deep South. Missouri farmers did not require many laborers to successfully practice the diversified agriculture that was common to the region. Overseers were rarely needed. Instead, most slaveholding men and women worked alongside their slaves, supervising and supplementing their labor in their homes and fields. Now, of course, enslaved people did the hardest of the work, but usually the owner and the master and the mistress were overseeing this work. The relations of farm life allowed slaves and owners to influence one another in significant ways. The personal and work interactions of Missouri slavery were intimate, exposing both parties to a vast array of human exchanges that range from empathy and cooperation to hatred and brutal violence. Now, on the one hand, enslaved people were well placed to understand the personalities of their owners and use this knowledge to their advantage. The marginal economic conditions of small-scale slavery, coupled with the tenuous nature of life on the border, encouraged slave resistance and undermined the authority of owners. Some owners felt an affinity with those with whom they lived and worked so closely, resulting in better treatment of a few favored slaves. Now, on the other hand, slaves were exposed to the worst forms of physical and psychological abuse, and this included the sexual exploitation of enslaved women. In the end, the quality of these relationships often depended on slaveholders' personalities and whims. Although white Missourians long argued that slavery was more benign in their border location, the historical evidence suggests that this was not true in most cases. Compared to the Deep South, slavery was indeed different, but this never translated into a, quote, better system of bondage. Rather, Missouri slavery was often just as cruel and as exploitative as anywhere else. Now, I could speak at great length about the ways in which white Missourians devastated enslaved people's lives, but tonight what I want to do is instead focus on the ways in which enslaved men and women took advantage of the attributes of small-scale border slavery to push back against white enslavers' attempts to control and dehumanize them. Although it often proved a double-edged sword, the close proximity in which Missouri slaves and their owners lived and worked could sometimes benefit slaves. Small-scale slavery provided them with the tools to shape their relations with their owners in ways that generally were not possible for the average plantation slave. By virtue of their close daily relations, they were well-placed to study their owners' personalities and use this knowledge to their advantage, notably by exploiting their masters' and mistresses' personal weaknesses in order to gain greater control over their circumstances. Now, enslaved individuals throughout the South used resistance as a means of negotiating their situation, but these efforts were especially effective on small slaveholdings because they were directed at the individuals with whom they shared such a great part of their lives. The personal interactions between owners and slaves often resulted in a breakdown in deference and moments of defiance of master's and mistress's authority. As an example, Aga and Dilsey studied the tense relations among the white members of the Stratton household, most especially those between their young mistress and her live-in mother-in-law, so the age-old story. They frequently exploited the white women's very, very rancorous relationship by playing one woman off of the other, usually by telling a story to one or trying to go to, you know, a certain one to get something that they knew the other one wouldn't give them. These were the kinds of things that they would do. And occasionally they even made verbal threats against these women. Others used their intimate knowledge of household relations to blackmail their owners or to simply enact vengeance against those who they believed had wronged them. Esther Easter took revenge on her owners by informing her master that she had witnessed his wife engaging in sexual relations with a neighbor man while he was off to war. She'd watched this through a crack in the wall. Enslaved women and men hoped to improve their conditions through these exchanges, and sometimes, in fact, they did. But at the very least, they may have released pent-up hostilities, gaining satisfaction through the acts of confrontation and revenge. Now, systemic aspects of Missouri slavery also provided enslaved men and women with opportunities for resistance. This is actually the Jesse James farm up in Kearney. And you can see how small this household was. There were a few slaves on this property, and they probably lived in a cabin out behind the house, but these were pretty cramped quarters that people were operating in. The tactics that enslaved Missourians used to sabotage the smooth functioning and economic profitability of the state's farms did not differ significantly from those used in the plantation south, although I would argue the impact of this resistance could be much greater. So on a large plantation, one slave's slow performance or truancy or theft did not substantially affect the enterprise's overall economic stability. Yet economic resistance on smaller holdings could result in immediate and destructive financial consequences, especially if there were only one or two workers on the farm. So enslaved men and women expertly undermined the economy of Missouri farms through acts of sabotage that range from theft and work slowdowns to running away and violent resistance. The pervasive practice of slave hiring also contributed to the difficulties that some Missouri owners had managing their slaves. Missourians such as Walter and Sarah Lenore of Boone County commonly hired out their slaves, including children. This is a very common thing that occurred. To their neighbors in an effort to maximize the economic potential of underutilized workers, or to, and this again happened very often, provide income for heirs while estates were in probate. Hiring demanded that slaves recognize the authority of two masters. Yet, hirers were unable to command the same respect, both under the law and in practice, as could owners. So what happened is some slaves used this to their advantage by resisting the authority of the men and women who only temporarily employed them. Slaveholders regularly punished slaves for their resistance, but slaves used these methods of protest and negotiation so regularly that some owners ignored minor offenses or chalked the behavior up to laziness or ineptitude. And I think this is because very few slaveholders could admit to themselves that their workers were acting out against them. For if they did that, they would have to face the reality that would basically shatter their illusion that their slaves were content in their enslavement. A few implicitly understood that resistance was one of enslaved people's only means to shape their lives, and they recognized that it was in their best interest to compromise with their workers in order to keep them reasonably content and productive. In the end, most slaves and owners would rather negotiate in order to minimize conflict, but invariably, when their expectations were disappointed and more traditional avenues of negotiation and resistance failed, the situation could erupt into violence. Southern slavery was fundamentally undergirded by violence. Although not all owners maintained their mastery through brutality, They used the possibility of violence to intimidate and control people. That said, slaveholders recognized that slaves might likewise violently respond to them. Men and women occasionally resisted their enslavement through dramatic and even violent acts of resistance, such as running away, physical attacks, and even murder. The intimacy of small slaveholding households made these forms of resistance particularly odious to slaveholders and therefore extremely effective. Now, as was true throughout the South, men and women used escape as a means of resisting slavery. Here's a runaway ad from the time. They typically fled spontaneously in response to threats of punishment or sale, or occasionally in an effort to influence their owner's actions. Now, most of them would hide in the nearby woods or at a friend's or relative's cabin and return later to face the consequences. So they were essentially supported by the slave community and their family members while they were away. The decision to engage in what historians have called truancy was not made lightly, though, because the consequences could be very, very grave. Whippings and occasionally even sale greeted many when they returned from their time at large. Although in the end, some owners actually overlooked these infractions in the interest of putting people back to work, especially if it was planting or harvesting time. As the antebellum years progressed, Missouri slaveholders increasingly feared that the precarious location of the state, coupled with the threat of anti-slavery agitators, would influence their slaves to flee. Now, of course, free states or territories surrounded Missouri on three sides, and foreign-born and northern immigrants moved to the state in greater numbers after the 1830s. So, slaveholders' fears were grounded in some sense of reality, since over the years, some Missouri slaves did successfully achieve their freedom. And, of course, you know, for those who did run away, the chances of success, at least compared to the Deep South, were increased by the state's geography. But stories of successful escapes, especially those of people spirited away from abolitionists, which was their real horror, the slaveholders' real horror, they were greatly exaggerated. In fact, most people who fled were caught before leaving the state, and often even before they got out of their own neighborhoods. Owners raised the alarm locally, and they frequently took out advertisements like this one in regional newspapers. In addition, white Missourians actively worked to preserve slavery through the creation of neighborhood slave patrols. Both slaveholding and non-slaveholding whites served on these patrols, which attempted to maintain labor discipline, thwart rebellion, and capture escaped slaves through community-sanctioned intimidation and violence. In fact, most slaves remained in place because they inherently understood that successful escapes were unlikely, and they feared the potential consequences of failure. Missouri slaves lashed out against their enslavement in more dramatic and violent ways as well. The intimacy of small-scale slavery had the potential to lead to volatile relations between owners and slaves, and when the tensions were too great, the situation rapidly deteriorated. Although it was most often slaveholders who physically abused their slaves, Missouri slaves occasionally violently attacked their owners. Physical punishment was routinely used as a method of discipline, and emotions were often so raw within small slaveholding households that everyday interactions could turn violent. For example, Paulina Stratton, who I was talking about a few minutes ago, hit her slave woman Aga with a stick when she refused to do work requested of her. And the angry slave woman, who believed that she had been unfairly disciplined, which of course she had, fought back, eventually hitting Stratton in the head as they tussled over a fire, like a fire poker. It's not surprising that slaves attempted to physically assault individuals of the same gender or age, as in the case of Paulina Stratton and Aga. But they occasionally were emboldened to act out against those who presumably were more physically powerful, such as when James Monroe Abbott's mother grabbed her master around the neck in response to his attempt to physically punish her. The ultimate form of resistance, of course, was when slaves took a life. Some deprived white Missourians of their human property through abortion, suicide, or infanticide, while others murdered members of the slaveholding family. Slaves were most likely to resort to these desperate acts when they felt threatened. And tragically, they sometimes turned this violence on themselves. Some chose death over continued physical or sexual abuse. But despondency over separation from loved ones and fear of the unknown, especially if they were propelled into the interstate slave trade or there was a threat that they were going to be, led others to take their own and sometimes even their children's lives. A few Missouri slaves murdered members of the slaveholding household, most often in self-defense, retaliation for abuse, or in response to a stressful or threatening situation. When those accused of murder were caught, they usually were summarily tried, convicted, and executed for their crimes. There were some lynchings, but usually the law took care of it at this point. So this was the case, true in the case of 16-year-old Henry, who shot his owner to protect himself from a whipping. And it was also true in the well-documented case of the sexually abused Callaway County young woman, Celia, who you've already heard about tonight, who murdered her master and burned his remains in her fireplace. And you obviously will hear much more about that next month. Occasionally, slaves banded together to murder white Missourians, as happened in Boone County in 1843, when three men and two women murdered their master with an axe, which seemingly was a weapon of choice among the enslaved. Enslaved men and women killed relatively few people, but in the wake of these incidents, white Missourians' fears were exposed. As they spread the news through their personal correspondence, you'll see it go from letter to letter, and as the stories were reported and republished in newspapers throughout the region, and the murder could happen here or it could happen in Kentucky or Virginia, and they were writing about it. They were obviously, you know, it's a sort of an underlying fear that that only bubbles to the surface here and there. It's clear that many of these people were fearful that at any time they too might fall victim at the hands of those with whom they lived and worked so closely. White Missourians also were anxious about the possibility of larger organized slave revolts. An aborted slave insurrection plot was reported in the Fulton area in 1842, and in 1849, the attempt of 30 northeastern Missouri slaves to make their way to freedom, they were heading toward Iowa, ended in an exchange of gunfire. And ultimately, they were captured and they were sold south, is what happened to most all of them. Acknowledging the potential for collective violence, Missourians enacted laws that made it illegal for slaves to gather without a white person present. They strengthened neighborhood slave patrols, and they vigilantly watched for signs of trouble. In the end, of course, slaves were much more likely to suffer violence at the hands of their owners. Even though small-scale slavery provided enslaved people with increased opportunities for resistance, nothing changed the fact that they were the property of their owners, or they were purported to be, and even if complete domination was not possible, slaveholders controlled vital aspects of their lives. A cruel master or mistress could inflict devastating blows, and there were few, if any, checks on white people's abuses. The give and take of the relations of farm life regularly exploded into violence, and the decision of many white Missourians to place economic profit over humanitarian concerns frequently led to exploitation, neglect, and physical abuse. And of course, intimacy at its worst resulted in the sexual abuse of enslaved women at the hands of white men. But by far, enslaved Missourians were most profoundly affected by the impact of small-scale slavery on their family and community lives. Scholars of American slavery have often argued that the slave family and the slave quarter community, as well as religion, were important mitigating factors that worked to soften slavery's harshest blows. But in Missouri, the family and the community lives of slaves were severely circumscribed. The small number of slaves living on individual farms forced men and women to look elsewhere for sexual partners. Therefore, the nuclear family unit with the mother, father, and children living together was not the norm on Missouri's farms. Instead, the average slave family consisted of the mother and her children on one farm and the husband and the father on another. Now, typical was Spotswood and Ori Rice, a Howard County, Missouri couple who began their marriage in 1852, but spent the first 12 years of it living separately. So Spotswood was owned by one slaveholder and Ori and their children by another. Mary Bell, the Rice's daughter, described her parents as helping each other endure, quote, the hard times of slavery. Spotswood was allowed to visit his wife and children two nights a week. He came on Wednesdays and Saturdays. Bell's father often came to them bloodied from beatings he had received at the hands of the slave driver on his master's plantation, and his owner actually was a plantation owner. He had quite a few slaves. Ori would tend to his wounds, wash his clothes, and send him back to suffer more abuse. And after a particularly severe beating, Spotswood ran away and hid near his family's cabin while watching for a chance to escape to freedom. Mary's mother begged him not to leave in spite of the violence that he was continually suffering and the emotional toll that the separation was taking on the family, I think because she was concerned that she might never see him again. Historians of the slave family have acknowledged the existence of what were called abroad marriages throughout the South, but the importance of these unions has been de-emphasized, overshadowed by their focus on the resident marriages of most plantation slaves. It is impossible to ignore these relationships in Missouri, however, because nearly 60% of marriages were between couples living on different slave holdings. And this is a much, much higher percentage than historians have found elsewhere in the South. And truly, not that many people have tried to quantify this, but there has been some work on South Carolina. It was more like 30%. So this is, you know, pretty dramatically different. Custom dictated that slave men could regularly visit their wives, but couples relied on their owners to recognize these rights. Men were typically given written passes to see their families once on the weekend and then occasionally once during the week, and it all really kind of depended on the distance that they had to travel. The way it worked was that usually men would arrive for visits with their families on Saturday nights, kind of after work was over, and often left before sunrise on Monday morning. Now, most couples live within a few miles of each other, although some men journeyed much greater distances to spend a few short hours with their family. And in fact, I found some cases where owners would actually let them borrow a horse to go visit because they were at such a distance. Slave men in general, even those with resident wives, constantly struggled to protect and support their families in light of the lack of legal marriages and the power that slaveholders held over their lives. It was even more difficult for abroad men to provide their wives and children with emotional and economic support when they visited only once a week. So for most of each week, women headed the majority of households. Abroad families generally did not have the luxury of daily contact, but many created long-lasting relationships regardless of the many challenges. As in other parts of the South, enslaved Missourians showed an amazing ability to adapt to their very difficult circumstances. And I think given the alternative, most men, women, and children accepted the limitations of abroad families and relished the little time that they spent with one another. In the face of high mortality and the deprivations of slavery, Missouri's abroad marriages were actually remarkably stable. In fact, many unions, such as that as of Spotswood and Ori Rice, persisted long after slavery had ended. Living without the benefit of a slave quarter community and often even nuclear families, most enslaved Missourians resisted isolation by moving beyond their home farms to fashion cross-farm slave communities and kin networks within the state's small slaveholding districts. They knew others within their neighborhoods well, frequently meeting at church services, family events, and community gatherings. The work requirements of diversified agriculture and the conditions of small-scale slavery encouraged owner-sanctioned social interactions among slaves in the greater community. Slaves roamed the countryside, mostly men, doing their owner's business and participating in the extensive slave hiring system found in the state. Slaveholders also encouraged them to engage in social activities, such as work frolics, which is what they called them at the time, and church services that promoted their economic and management goals. So think of corn shuckings and barn raisings. But most important, they allowed liberal slave mobility in order to accommodate the many men and women who lived on separate farms. Men required opportunities to meet and court their future spouses and to visit with their families after they wed. Slaveholders inherently understood that the natural increase of Missouri's slave population was dependent on the creation of these abroad families. So therefore, they could not afford for their slaves to live in social isolation. Slaves gathered at the parties and dances that were held throughout the neighborhood on many Saturday evenings. These festivities often were in conjunction with work-related activities, where farmers frequently combined their small workforces to complete large jobs quickly and efficiently. Henry Black explained, during slavery, he had, quote, a good time at the local corn shuckings, quote, but we always shucked a lot of that corn. Slaveholders and slaves sometimes attended work frolics together, but not surprisingly, slaves performed most of the work. Hosts provided their enslaved visitors with dinner and sometimes a dance after the work was completed. They also attended slave weddings together, and one of the most common meeting places was at Missouri's many integrated churches on Sunday mornings. Enslaved men and women were unable to pursue their social interactions purely on their own terms, however. Owners rarely forbade their involvement in the greater community outright, but instead what they did is they tried to regulate their participation and monitor their activities. So whether at a wedding or a shucking party, white people were usually within earshot. In addition, most slaveholders required people to seek permission and a written pass before they ventured off the farm for a social engagement. They also oftentimes set curfews for them to be home. So controlling the movement of enslaved people was the primary purpose of these patrollers, although they were also on the lookout for signs of illegal activities, such as buying and selling goods. Of course, the concern was that slaves would sell their owners crops and goods away, and then unsanctioned gatherings. Now, despite their very best efforts, slaveholders could not always regulate their slave social lives. Enslaved Missourians, especially men, frequently left their cabins at night in search of social opportunities. Some people ventured out to local gatherings without the permission of their owners or remained out past the time that they were supposed to be home. Others attended unsupervised gatherings where they engaged in activities that were either against the wishes of their owners or were just simply illegal, such as slave-led church services. They didn't want for them to listen to ministers that they did not approve of. Or gambling and drinking parties in the woods. And not surprisingly, it's mostly young people who are engaging in this kind of activity. Whether meeting one another at churches, work parties, while visiting family, or clandestinely at night, enslaved Missourians were all the while forming vital connections with others in their communities. They knew their neighbors well, and that was the word that they would use. They established large networks of friends throughout the countryside. Missouri's inter-farm slave communities could not provide the daily support found in plantation slave quarters, you know, that historians have written so much about, but most Missouri slaves did not talk about these relationships as lacking. The many risks that they took and really the great lengths that they went to in order to maintain friendships and family ties demonstrates the importance of these relationships. The inter-farm slave community functioned differently than a plantation quarter community, yet slaves were able to lend a degree of emotional support and mutual assistance to one another just the same. They were able to enjoy the company of bond people and participate in the rich cultural heritage of the American slave community. These human connections forged across farm boundaries were vital to slave self-identity and their ability to survive their enslavement. These attempts to form families and create communities should be viewed as acts of resistance. Resistance to white Missourians' efforts to control their lives and resistance to the often demoralizing and dehumanizing aspects of slavery. Now, ultimately, enslaved Missourians drew on all of these many lessons that they had learned from resistance, and they marshaled all of their resources as they seized the opportunity that was presented by the violence and turmoil of Civil War era Missouri. White communities were ripped asunder during the war years, with neighbors literally fighting neighbors. These events exacerbated the already existing vulnerabilities of border state slavery. And many of Missouri's nearly 115,000 slaves took advantage of this chaos and struck a blow for their freedom. As the war progressed, thousands took emancipation into their own hands. Union soldiers like Jennison's Jayhawkers stole, and that was a word that white slaveholders like to use, some Missouri slaves. But most often, enslaved individuals recognized the presence of Union soldiers as an opportunity. Men, women, and children fled to Union military encampments that were scattered throughout the countryside, and they were especially quite a few of them in the Missouri River counties, where the largest slaveholding population was, and where there were more people who might be for the South. During the first years of the war, there was considerable debate among officers in these camps about the status of these runaways. Could they keep them? Could they not? Were they slaves still, or were they free? But by the final years of the war, they no longer debated whether they should be free, but rather how best to protect the many who already really were. Many white Missourians clung tenaciously and often violently to slavery, even as the system began to collapse from within. Former slave Tishy Taylor remembered, quote, "Nearer time for us to be freed, the owners got meaner all the time." Slaveholders desperately attempted to control the local slave population and even employed Confederate guerrillas in this effort. They harassed local slaves, they threatened white Missourians who hired former slaves for pay, and later they intimidated slave men to try to keep them from enlisting in the Union Army. And so all these harrowing circumstances made it an extreme act of bravery to try to get away. In the summer of 1862, the Union Army began to enlist African American men as soldiers. Jim Lane, who was the sitting senator from Kansas, organized one of the first African American regiments, primarily made up of former Missouri slaves who had escaped into Kansas. And in late October 1862, these men engaged in the first armed military action by African American troops during the Civil War, so way before the 54th and the glory story. At the Battle of Island Mound, which was just over the border from Kansas in Bates County, Missouri. Many others crossed over the state line into Iowa and Illinois, filling the ranks of the African American forces recruited in those states. Men still living in Missouri could not officially enlist until November of 1863, when the Union Army finally authorized the recruitment of all slave men within the state. By this point, men understood that enlistment would result in their immediate freedom, would allow them to assert their manhood and rights to citizenship, and might result in the liberation of their families as well. Men literally risked their lives as they journeyed to recruitment stations because the guerrillas really were out to try to stop them and would even kill them on their way there. In the end, a few over 8,000 formerly enslaved Missourians served in the 5 United States African American regiments that were actually recruited in the state of Missouri, but many more enlisted in nearby states. Now, while calculating the risks of enlistment, men also consider the consequences of their actions for their families. Some women and children followed their husbands and fathers to army posts, but many more initially remained with their owners. Women often suffered because of their husbands' and sons' decisions. Owners expected that the work of the farm would continue even after the men left, and many women complained that they were now required to do, quote, the work formerly performed by men. Some owners treated women and children cruelly, while others callously pushed them off of their farms, now considering them a financial liability. One woman complained to her husband that her owners were, quote, treating me worse and worse every day. Many soldiers agonized over the fate of their loved ones, pleading with Union military officials to intercede on their behalf. And some, like Spotswood Rice, argued that their military service guaranteed the freedom and protection of their family members. Rice went so far as to write a letter threatening his daughter Mary's mistress, and in it he proclaimed, quote, "Now you call my children your property, not so with me. My children is my own, and I expect to get them, and when I get ready to come after Mary, I will have about a power and authority to bring her away and to execute vengeance on them that holds my child." So he is, you know, he's evoking the power of the federal government and the Union Army to help him free his child. Others actually took matters into their own hands and liberated their family members who remained in bondage. And there's this wonderful story of how a group of black and white Union soldiers marched into central Missouri and set about liberating the formerly enslaved men's wives and children from the farms. They liberated a lot of other property too, but they helped these women escape, and women and children escape. And I can only imagine how horrifying that sight must have been to white Missourians here in central Missouri to see black and white men wearing the blue uniform and carrying guns. Enslaved Missourians left for the surrounding free states by the thousands after the summer of 1863. But many who hazarded running away faced an uncertain future in freedom. Union officials and aid workers in both Missouri and the surrounding states repeatedly wrote to their superiors asking for assistance in caring for the refugee women and children who were now suffering in their midst. On January 11th, 1865, Missouri slaves were officially emancipated, so this is ahead of the 13th Amendment, were officially emancipated by a resolution of the now Republican-controlled Missouri State Constitutional Convention. But by this time, most, or maybe I should say many, especially enlistment-age men, were already free. The road to freedom had been long. It stretched back to the times when enslaved Missourians regularly contested the terms of their labor and their living arrangements. The struggles between slaves and their owners were often intensely personal and frequently ended in violent confrontation. But enslaved Missourians resisted the dehumanizing effects of slavery by forging strong emotional ties with their fellow bondspeople, in spite of the many strictures that were placed on them by their owners. The long fight to bolster their self-esteem and to maintain human connections in the face of the degradations of slavery was finally near its end. The years ahead would prove to be very difficult for both black and white Missourians as they forged a new relationship in freedom. But for former slaveholders and slaves who had fashioned a very troubled coexistence in small-scale slavery, the ambiguities and extremes of their lives on slavery's border had ended. Thank you.
We have some time for questions and answers. I believe we'll have some mics that will be placed in either aisle. Who will be the brave first question?
Good evening, Diane. Tracy Wilson, Klee Camp.
Oh, hi.
How are you?
Good.
I'm glad you're here. I just came from Stevens College and did a presentation on doing African-American genealogy, or just genealogy. But I like the idea, or I think it's important to understand how deep resistance was. Have you followed anything more on the children who were refugees in the camps? And what was done for them?
Well, that's part of my next project. So I'm just sort of starting into that. I became fascinated with this question when I was working on the On Slavery's Border book. You know, I was working on enhancing the chapter on the Civil War, and I started reading all these military records that talked about refugees, and not just slaves who were, you know, that at the time they called contraband, which is kind of not a great word, but that's the word that they used at the time. But also a lot of white refugees were flooding into these military encampments. And it appears that they were trying their best to deal with the situation, but they didn't have a lot of resources. They kept asking, you know, kind of up the chain of command, what can we do? Can we give them you know, basically material goods that should be going to soldiers? Can we give them to people? Can we employ them? You know, ultimately, can we arm them? And, you know, and it kind of, there were questions that, I mean, it took time to figure that out. It does appear that, especially with those aid organizations, and the main one was the Western Sanitary Commission in St. Louis, that they treated white Unionist refugees a bit better than they did African American refugees, but they were trying to help them as well. It just seems that they seem to be a little bit more concerned about the white people. So I'm not quite sure yet, but I'm working on it. All right, here they come. I thought you were all going to try to get out of here to go watch the ball game.
Hi. You spoke about people being sold down south, you know, mm-hmm. as for whatever reason. I'm curious about how the population of slaves developed, where they came from. What was the source of the population here, and did it maintain itself? Did people like bring in new slaves, or were they like exported, excess exported rather than sold down the river? Uh-huh. You know, just that whole population dynamic.
That's a good question, and that was something that was really difficult to get a handle on. Anecdotally, I kept seeing people talking about, even in accounts that former slaves told, so either in the pension records or in the WPA narratives, which were interviews that were conducted in the 1930s, I kept seeing more people talking about coming with their owners than actually being brought here in as part of the slave trade, although we know that that happened because there were ads, selling people. So we know that it happened. People came both ways, but it does appear that a lot of people came with it was a forced migration, basically, which could have the same kind of consequences because oftentimes people were coming from small slaveholding regions, in Virginia or Kentucky, and they were involved in abroad marriages there, for example, or they were they had family members that were on various slaveholdings, and so the consequence could be the same. Even if they were coming with their owners, they could still be separated from their family members, and there's all sorts of evidence that occurred. It appears that there was, I will outright say it, there is a demand for labor, especially in western Missouri, really up until the Civil War. And so it appears that a lot of people are sold, but they're sold locally. And then there's this very robust hiring system that is just pervasive throughout this region. Now, that's not to say that people weren't sold south. There were many people who were sold south to places like Louisiana. And, there's this famous slave trader here in central Missouri named John White who, sold hundreds of people to the south. So it did happen, but even throughout the South, it's estimated that about 2/3 of people who were sold within their local communities. So that might have allowed people to maintain some of their relationships that they had instead of all of that being totally blown apart. But still, your circumstances could change dramatically based on who you were sold to. So it's hard to know. There are some demographic models. It seems like they started selling people more from like the Mississippi River counties than they did from around here south. Okay, another question?
I was just interested in the fact that something really surprised me, that the churches were mixed. Uh-huh. Did the slave owners force their slaves to come to services? How did it work
how
in
did that
church?
Work?
I just can't even imagine.
Well, it's interesting. If you look at church records for most of the, what would now be mainline Protestant churches, but they were evangelical churches at the time, the Baptists, the Methodists, the Presbyterians, really the populations, the congregants in these churches oftentimes really reflected the slave population in the county. So, maybe 1/3 of people in some cases were slaves. They were not treated entirely equally within these churches, as you can imagine. They sometimes were, oftentimes they had to sit at the back of the church or up in a gallery. they were involved in the life of the church in various ways, but they certainly didn't serve in any kind of leadership role, and it was always a white minister who was probably preaching a message that was appealing to the white slaveholders, but not appealing to them, which is why they look for these alternative opportunities, church opportunities, oftentimes clandestine with their own preachers. Mm-hmm. And that was not much approved of by owners because they were preaching different kinds of messages in their own churches. But it appears that a lot of people wanted to go to these churches because not only was it a religious experience, but also it was a social one. And churches' services lasted really long. And oftentimes there was lunch involved. And when I looked at the Civil War pension records of African-American soldiers and their dependents, they talked a lot about knowing people because they knew them from church. So it was obviously, you know, serving this other purpose. So sometimes, to answer the other part of your question, sometimes they had to go to the church of their owner, but sometimes their owners didn't care where they went. So Paulina Stratton, she went to the Presbyterian Church, but she talks a lot about this slave man named Ike who goes to the Mount Nebo Baptist Church.
Bearing in mind when Melissa Harris Perry, the political scientist, came, she talked about the relatively recent phenomenon of people identifying as biracial, given that it just took one drop of blood in this country to be considered black and to be a slave. But I'm curious if you know anything about this population. You mentioned the sexual exploitation of black women, often by white men. And there was a fruit of those relationships, however abhorrent to us now or dysfunctional. We have some examples of people from that population who have become very well known and renowned. But anything you can tell me about that population, how prevalent it was, and any kind of special challenges or any differentiation in roles, that would be appreciated.
Okay. Well, again, this is a really hard thing to quantify, but I tried in the book. I tried to do that. And the way I did that is by basically counting how people self-reported. You can also look at the census, but that's a little bit, basically that's a census enumerator deciding what he thinks about somebody's, about racial categories. And usually, you know, people were either marked as black or mulatto. Those were the terms that they used. And so that was kind of, you know, based on vision or based on what he was told. So that's a little bit less reliable than I think people telling who their fathers were. And it appears, and there's some other people who have done some work on this, it appears on these small slave holdings that this was much more prevalent, and it makes sense. If there's one woman on a farm as opposed to 20 women on a plantation, then that one woman, like Celia, for example, the only slave woman on that property is going to be the focus of the, you know, man's attention. There appears to have been a continuum of just outright abuse to some kind of relationship, but, you know, can you really call it a relationship because it's a coerced relationship. Power relations between men and women were never equal during this time. But this is an even more unequal power relationship. But, you know, a friend of mine has done some work on this family in outside of St. Louis in St. Charles County, where it was a long-term relationship between a man and his slave woman. And then it continues after slavery ends. Eventually, the relationship breaks apart, but he has a number of children by this woman, and he ends up leaving a tremendous amount of property to them. And his white wife, who was his actual only legal wife, who he marries out of state, some cousin of his who lived in West Virginia or something, she doesn't even know about this other family. And he keeps coming back to Missouri to visit his property, you know, his farm, but really he's coming back to visit his family. And he gets really ill, and he's dying, and she comes to see him and basically sees all of this long stream of, you know, mixed race people coming in to visit him, and finds out about this past life of his. And so she ends up contesting the will. And not surprisingly, she wins. Although the story kind of has a bit of a happy ending, if you can call it that. She ends up selling the property that should have been by rights these children, children's property, to them at kind of a reduced price. But she still gets, you know, she still gets her money out of it. So there's all sorts of strange things that can occur. But there was a lot of it, I guess is the short answer.
That will be all for now. Let's thank Professor Mutti Burke. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Just two things. There's a survey going around that we're hoping that you'll fill out and give us a sense of your experience and ways that we can plan further. Also, there's a book signing with Professor Mutti Burke immediately following. Thank you so much for coming. Have a good night.